Thank you, Dr. Vardhan Saab, for my introduction. And thank you, Dr. The organizer of this, Dr. Ranjit Singh. I'm very happy that I'm again come for the review of the lecture here. So I have to share now with my this thing. Shall I start, Dr. Ranjit or Dr. Vardhan Saab?
Yes, sure.
You know that in our society there are a number of crimes took place regularly, particularly in the in our country. There are huge amount of crimes taken place by the firearms and their ammunition. You see, there is a newspaper cutting. So that is regularly happen in our country. So from the very small basic things, people are doing such a heinous crime with the help of the firearm. So this is just example. I'm showing you how these firearm crimes are took place in our country. Then you see, this is the celebrity firing. You see, there are a number of incidences in our country. The celebrity firing taken the very serious in our country. So you see, this is the one case in which there is a marriage ceremony was going on, and this is the celebrity firing. One that particular groom was died with the hit of the gunshot injury. So he died due to this celebrity firing. Then this is the another case also here. One dancer was died due to this celebrity firing. So type of the patterns are regularly happening in most of the northern part of India. So this crime taken place by the help of the firearms and ammunition are regularly happening in our country. So now day by day these crimes are increasing in our place. So there is some another major factor in our country, this firearm. There is a public gang wars are also there. So there are a lot of gangsters are died due to the law enforcement agencies, where with the law enforcement agencies or police personnel. So there are a number of these gang wars between the law enforcement, police, and the gangs members. So this is the one place, a public place, there was a shooting takes place in one place. So now I am coming to this much, just starting the topic with the forensic ballistics. And what is the forensic ballistics then? The main definition, generally we say that the person can handle a weapon very easily, person can use the weapon very easily, person can move the weapon very easily. That means handling, operation, and movement. The person does do very easily. That is called the ballistic. But this is the general ballistics of the definition. If we see as per the 1959 Indian Arms Act, there is totally different definition in here. What is the definition then? That one, the internal cross-sectional diameter of the barrel is less than 1 is known as the small arm, or we can say the small arm. So whichever the diameter of the barrel is less than 1, it comes under the on small arm. So definition of this ballistic, you see, there are different types of the projectiles in our in the world. So just like if we take our Indian example, Prithvi, Trishul, Nag, this one of the space projectiles. So these are the also projectiles. But in our forensic ballistics, we are generally doing the examination and reporting in the small arms cases only. So that is why the small arms means the internal diameter of the barrel is less than 1. So there are different varieties of the ballistic. This is the general definition of the ballistic. Ballistics means the motion of the projectile within the gun, outside the gun, and inside the target. How the bullet behaves inside within gun, outside the gun, and within the target itself. So there may be target, maybe the solid, there may be target, maybe the human being or any animal. So there are different types of the forensic ballistics. So this one of the ballistics means the motion of the projectile within the gun. Is whatever the behavior of the projectile within the gun is on the internal ballistics. And then the same bullet is come out from the barrel, just come out, and it is the near of the muzzling, that is called the intermediate ballistics. And when the motion of the projectile or behavior of the projectile, how it behaves inside inside the air, it's air, how it behaves, whether it goes on stay on position, or whether it is tumbling, it's a tumbling, or whether it is a whatever the behavior of the projectile inside the air is known as the terminal ballistic, is known as external ballistic. So external ballistic is behavior of the projectile within the air. How it goes, whether it is straight way or whether it is a trajectory path and all these things, whatever the things coming, projectile behavior, that is the external ballistic. And the same bullet, when it hits to the target, target, this depends upon the whether the target is a solid thing or whether the target is a human thing. So the target is the solid thing here, the bullet hit to the target, but it lodges within the target. It does not come out from the target. So the penetration, that is called the penetration. The penetration is the projectile space. The bullet hits to the target and lodges within the body or lodges within the target. That is called the terminal ballistics. And when the same bullet hits to the human being or any animal which made the injury, that is called the wound ballistics. Wound ballistics. And now there is also two types of the wound ballistics. One is the penetration of the projectile, another one is the perforation of the projectile. Perforation means the through and through, when the bullet hits to the target and come out from the target through and through. So that is called the perforation of the target. So this is the variety, various types of the forensic ballistics. So it may be the internal ballistic, motion of the projectile within the gun, motion of the projectile within the air, motion of the projectile within the target, and terminal or wound ballistic. So these are the forensic ballistics. So now that I told you the what is the small arms there? Small arms means the persons can handle the weapon very easily, persons can operate the weapon very easily, and persons can move the weapon very easily. That means handling, operation, and movement of the small arms, that is known as a small arm. But in arms act, the diameter of the barrel is less than 1 inch for the small arm. So we are dealing the forensic as a forensic expert or as a forensic ballistic. We are dealing the cases of a small arms cases only. There are medium machine guns, there are big machine guns are there, military guns are there. We are not dealing with that one. As per the law, we are dealing the whatever the diameter is less than, which means diameter, 1 inch diameter, we are doing the cases in forensic ballistics. So, what the question rises here? So, what the ballistic evidence helps to explain? But if we see, if the investigating officer attends the scene of crime and shooting incident, what type of the ballistic evidence he will get it? And from seeing by the naked eye, when he sees what type of the he can explain, or ballistic evidence can explain to help to the investigating officer. So then the question rises here again, what type of the firearm was used in a particular crime? What are the caliber of the bullet? What are the, how many bullets were fired from a particular place in case of the revolver firing? And what was the position of the shooter? And when the firearm was fired recently or not? And then actually this recently firing or not, scientifically, it is not exactly we can tell, but still, whether the particular weapon was recently fired or not, with the help of the firearm discharge residue, we can tell. But scientifically, we are not exactly sure whether the firearm was fired exact so and so and exact this time. Then coming to the what is the distance between the distance determination between the victim and the accused. Somebody called to the person from the house and he shoot him and run away. Here the question rises, what is the distance between the shooter and the victim? So here in forensic ballistics or in ballistic evidence, we can get there are different evidence we can get from the scene of crime. There is a burning, blackening, tattooing on the victim's body, If the 12-bore gun is used, there is a pellet and shot or the concentrate. So whatever may be, there we will get the firing residue, or we can get the firing pellets on the scene of crime. And there is some bullet mark on the wall of the scene of crime. So all these things, we can estimate the range of firing with the help of burning, blackening, tattooing, this firing range estimation phenomenon. And then we can also identify with the help of the shooter identification. Whether the particular crime took place between the two persons, somebody claiming they may be taken the advantages, there is a coupling between the both persons. So another, this here, on the basis of the gunshot residual particle present on the shooter's hand, or both shooter's hand, or if somebody has fired homicidal cases, so the accused hand, the scientist collected, or generally the investigating officer collect the gunshot residue from the shooter's hand. I will complete get the pictures afterward. So the shooter identification of the person we can identify in the forensic science laboratory. And then another question that is at the scene of crime, whether the particular weapon which is recovered from the scene of crime is a working condition or not, whether it is a that particular weapon is a firearm or not, or ammunition or not. So if the working condition, the firearm is not in working condition, ammunition is a different way, there may be another, then there is the question. So generally, the ballistic evidence which is available at the scene of crime, we can say that the particular firearm which is recovered from the crime spot is a working condition or not. On that basis only, the further action by the legal department will take place. Then, an important point here, I would like to say that generally forensic ballistic evidence, there is a two major evidence took place, just like a fired bullet from the particular plan, whether the particular bullet is fired from a particular weapon or not, or empty cartridge cases recovered from the scene of crime had been fired from a particular firearm or not. So these two evidences, which is the fired from the, or the bullet which is recovered from the body of the victim or the scene of crime, and then we fired in the laboratory, test fired in the laboratory, test recovered the cartridge cases or test bullet in the laboratory. Then we compare under the microscope, and then if there is a striation marks are matching with the evidence bullet or recovered from the body of the victim, then we can say that this particular bullet is fired from a particular gun or not. Then another question also here, the bullet was whether on the scene of crime, if we get or is not on the wall or on the wood or any other target, solid target, there is a gunshot, a bullet hole is, if we get, whether that particular hole is done by the, is caused by the particular bullet or not. And that basis, the forensic ballistic expert can give the vital information regarding the bullet hole identification on the target method, whether the particular hole found on the wall or found on the any other target is caused by the bullet or not. Another expert also said, how ballistic experts give the opinion, whether the particular suspect firearm is killed a particular person or not, on the basis of the velocity measuring, whether particular, if the particular consumer pistol or particular firearm is more than 200 feet per second velocity, then we can say that particular weapon used in a particular crime that can be killed to a person. That will also depend upon the particular body of the person. Suppose somebody fires the vital portion part of the body, and there is a ear gun is also there. So that depends upon the portion of the body where the projectile is. And then did the bullet come from the gun? These are the particular scene of crime or the firearm expert use the general opinion on this, whether there will be the really self-defense or purposefully he has to kill. So, and in this case, the firearm expert can do good examination, analysis, and do the opinion on that case, whether it was really fired by the for the purpose of the self-defense or not. Then in case of the suicidal cases or any foul play involved, the forensic expert on the basis of the contact residue on the basis of the contact residue or a bullet residue, we can come to the conclusion whether it was a suicidal nature or it is a homicidal nature or it was a accidental in nature. Then with the comparison of the fire bullets, we can say the particular bullets come up from fire from a particular gun or not. I already told you working condition of the firearm, and in general cases, if the particular firearm is safe or not, or whether it is a some modification has been done in particularly improvised firearm. Generally, in our country, there are I will come over here also. There is a most of the regular firearm has been modified, or they change their original look. So in that cases also, the firearm is produced vital information due to his in his opinion. And then there is a serial number installation, job transportation. All these things we can firearm expert can do the opinion on that. So this is I already told you the definition of the ballistic forensic science is the science of analyzing firearm bullets and their impact on it. Generally, these three words are there: forensic ballistic means there may be the firearm, there may be the ammunition, and there may be the impact where it the bullet is. So there are three things in forensic ballistic we are generally analyzing. One is the there must be the firearm, there must be the projectile, and there must be the target where the bullet projectile impacts it. So this is the forensic definition of the forensic ballistic. It's the science which analyzes the firearm and their projectile and their impact, the projectile's impact on the target. And ballistic fingerprinting and the firearm evidence determine if the particular firearm is found. This is the, if we take the automation, just like the integrated ballistic identification and system, this is the fingerprinting, ballistic fingerprinting in the form of the spatial mark, in the form of the firing pin, all these firing things I will come on that on. Then firearm identification, how we identify the firearm, whether the particular firearm is fired from a particular place or not. So with the help of the recovered bullet, we can identify a particular firearm, whether the bullet is fired from a particular gun, whether the type of firearm, what type of the firearm was involved in a particular crime. So this type of the firearm may be the handgun, means revolver, pistol, and there may be the rifle, there may be the assault rifle, there may be the service rifle, there may be the shotgun, may be there. And with the help, we can identify the firearm with the help of the serial number of the weapon, and we match to the licensing authority and others, and then we can say this is the so-and-so, this is the owner of so-and-so. The serial number, so we can identify the firearm with the help of the fired bullet, type of the firearm, and fired cartridge from the fired cartridge cases, from the even fingerprint also. Another, we can identify the gunshot residue pattern on the clothes of the hand or the wound, and then we also determine the target to muzzle distance. So on this thing, a firearm expert can do vital information to the investigating officer. So if we categorize the firearm, there are lots of the firearms are there. Then if we categorize, I will take the 1 hour for only classification of the firearm. But here is, I'm generally in a one slide only. There may be the handgun, the person who uses to shoot the person or to fire the person, that is the pistols and revolver. And then there is another gun with shoulder guns, long guns with shoulder guns, rifle and shotgun. And mounted guns on cannons, the anti-corruption, we are not dealing with the forensic ballistics. So this is the one of the handguns are there, revolvers. And this is the different types of the firearms I'm showing here. There is a handguns and shoulder guns also. Other shoulder guns, there is a assault rifle, submachine gun. But in our country, in our country, there is a total different picture out there. In other countries, persons or criminals or antisocial elements generally uses the standard firearms or regular firearms which are generally manufactured in the factories. They have their standard, their own standard of a particular manufacturer. But in our country, most of the 90% crimes taken place by the country-made firearms. and improvised financing. So in our country, there is a totally different scenario here. So these are the various types of the country-made pistols. You see, this is the country-made pistol. They are, these are also, we can more classify on these country-made pistols also. How is opening? There is a different type of the opening of the country-made pistol. There may be the different types of the locking system is also there. There may be the type of the pressing the trigger also. These are the, even with the help of this trigger also, we can identify this particular this country-made pistol is manufactured by the from the particular places. And these are the different types of the country-made pistols you see. And this is the country-made pistols and country-made revolvers also. Sometimes country-made revolvers are so they made it finished, their finishing is so likely as equal to the factory-made. So we cannot identify, but the firearm expert is opinion on the basis of its physical examination, the rifling, there is present rifling in the barrel or not. All these things we can identify. There were other portions, and they're made in USA, made in Italy, made in UK. They are, people are manufacturing like this, improvised. So this is also, this is a different ways of the country-made pistols and country-made revolver. So now the most of the crimes took place generally now with the help of these improvised pistols. So improvised pistols are widely used in our country, mostly in northern part of India. And now it's also reaching to the western and this south side also. So, but the criminals are there, why the people with country-made pistols and improvised pistols are people hunting by the criminal or by the intersectional element? Because they are manufacturing the only firearm, improvised firearm or country-made firearm. Here, the standard ammunition are available. So most of the standard ammunition is 8mm cartridge. It is 14 rifle cartridge, semi-jacketed bullet that is used for the rifle purpose, they are using in country-made pistols also. And another ammunition, which is a standard or licensed ammunition, is a 7.65 mm ammunition. It is semi, this is generally used for semi-automatic pistols or 0.32 pistol. So this is the 0.32 ammunition are generally used in an improvised pistol. So this is the different variety, various types of the improvised pistols are using, their people are using the standard ammunition. So these are the improvised rifles, you see. There are some rifles are here. The regular cartridges are available in the market. Or the criminals get the regular cartridges from the other source, a standard source, we can say, from the government or some other. I don't know that one, but they are manufacturing the improvised rifle in such a way that they can get the ammunition easily, standard ammunition from the factory made ammunition. So this is the improvised rifle generally. This most of the improvised rifles are used at the eastern part of the country. Eastern part now that still the people are using these improvised rifles. So you see, this is very there is a the manufacturer makeshift are very, very easy to use. They are generally using this 0.303 ammunition, 0.7.62 ammunition, and particularly on 12 bore ammunition, these improvised rifles are available. So another thing is, one improvised pistol or improvised gun, one gun can be fired at different types of the caliber of the ammunition. So I can say yes. So one gun can fire a different type of the caliber of the ammunition or not. Yes. The people are so sharp. You see, they make the one barrel, they make the another two barrels of the different caliber, and there is a slide in there, you see. Multiple barrels of different ammunition. So one machine can be fired a different type of the caliber of the ammunition. So you see three barrels are there. And there is one only base portion of the barrel, and they are putting this changing the barrel with the changing caliber. So one gun can fire different types of ammunition. So this is the pen gun where the 0.22 ammunitions are used to fire the gun, to fire the ammunition, 0.22 ammunition. So the our people, the criminals or anti-social elements, they are not using factory, big factory for making the illegal firearms and their ammunition. But still here, with the simple lead machine, they are manufacturing this cartridge. There is, you see here, there is a solid brass rod in here. And brass rod, they are making the bullet, they are making the cartridge cases, they are making the percussion cap, and they are making the even every type of the cartridge with the help of this lead machine. Simple techniques they are using to manufacture the improvised pistol. And similarly, for the trigger purpose, they are using the locks reverse. The locks, you know, general locks, we are locks. They are using the reverse of the lock for the trigger purpose. You see, one lead machine is there and they are manufacturing lots of the, this is the factory which was recovered. Seized by the police personnel, they were going to manufacture this improvised pistol. You see, there is one cutter is required. There is a death machine is required, and with the, you see, there is a block they are using, and blocks are generally they are making their shape, their sliding portion, their firing pin, their spring, their trigger guard and trigger, with all these things they are manufacturing separately with the help of the simple lead machine. And the ammunition, what is the ammunition? If you see, ammunition is what? Ammunition is an assembly which creates a power inside the gun. It's an assembly which creates a power inside the gun. So ammunition has a different type of the ammunition. There may be the, I'm showing here different types of the ammunition. There may be the, some round nose, there may be the sharp nose, there may be the different types of, there may be semi-automatic, semi-jacketed, jacketed, non-jacketed, completely lead ammunition. There are variety of the ammunition. So my intention is to tell you what is ammunition. Ammunition is the assembly which creates a power inside. Now, the question here, somebody may be asked here, what is ammunition or cartridge? In our ballistic language, ammunition is a part, it is a cartridge. Cartridge consists of a cartridge case, it consists of a bullet, it consists of a percussion cap, it consists of a propeller. Propeller, maybe the I'm telling propeller, maybe the semi black powder, maybe the smokeless powder. So all these things consist of a cartridge, or in our police bhasha, or police language, it is a round. Round consists of a cartridge case, bullet, percussion cap, and the propeller. So each, there is a different type of the ammunition. There is a ammunition in the form of the only making the sound, also, noise, sound. So there is a blank ammunition is also there. There may be the demonstration ammunition. There may be the plastic bullets ammunition. So these are the demonstration ammunition. Then there is a different sharp nose bullets. There is a copper nickel. Generally, ammunitions are made by the copper nickel or copper zinc. Copper zinc and copper nickel. On this basis, we can identify the what type of the ammunition has been used in a particular crime. So these are the different types of the bullets internal part. This is the anatomy of the, we can say, ammunition. Anatomy of the ammunition. You see, there is a cartridge. There is a cartridge consists of a bullet, then powder, primer, case, percussion cap, powder, black powder, or smokeless powder. But in this shotgun shell, we see here, this is the different type. This is the same here, but shotgun, there is a air cushion mats are used to seal the gas. So this is the only difference between the regular cartridge and the 12-volt cartridge. So the, on the basis of the head stamp also, the ballistic expert can identify the from which country it has been fired. And the head stamp is very, very important for the investigation purpose, which country it was at what factory. Most of the countries having their own head stamp mark, and there is the angle, the particular angle, particular angular marking gives a particular specific information. So suppose here 93 or 0590. So this 05 is a factory code 90 may be the manufacturing in a particular 1990. So these are given various symbol that vary from country to country. So on the basis of the head stamp mark, we can exactly on the available record in the forensic laboratory, we can say that the particular cartridge is manufactured from a particular country and particular factory. So this is the 12 bore cartridge. I told you in 12 bore cartridge only there are two types of the ammunition only. One is the bullet. Two types of ammunition means one is the bullet having the spherical shape and another bullet having the cylindro conical bullet. So the generally in shotgun there is a small pellets are used or small shots are used. There may be the buckshot, there may be the LG, FG, MG, and up to the dust there is the 2,500 small pellets are used by the particular person. But two times, but in 12 more cartridges start from the LG to dust cartridge 2,500. So there may be the one cartridge number 1, 2, 3, 4, and each cartridge having their own individual shape and size and their different weight of the pellet or shot. If we recover the one pellet from the synapse crime having a specific shape or having the specific dimension, we can say that this shot is belong to the one number or two number or three number of cartridge. The shot is deformed at the synapse crime, then what will happen? If the shot, though it is deformed in the synapse crime, it is hitting to the solid surface and it changes dimension, then on the basis of the weight also, we can identify the particular shot is belong to a by weighing the particular shot pellet, we can identify the particular number of the cartridge. The basis of this one, shotgun barrel generally fires the number of shots. So in regular firearms, you see there is a general rattling are done with for the giving the to achieving the effective range, to achieving the killing range, or to maximum killing. So this is the rattling are done to so that the maximum velocity can be achieved to a maximum killing range can or maximum effective range. For that purpose, the factory in the during in the manufacturing the factory, the there is some lands and grooves are there. So this is the this is lands and grooves. This is the groove portion to difference. It's also lands and grooves also vary from weapon to weapon. These are the classical characteristics of the bullet. There is a rattling is a left hand or right hand. There is the width of the rattling, depth of the rattling, and there is the number of lands and grooves. So these are the classical standards of a rifle. So on that basis, the firearm expert can identify four lands and four grooves are there. So that means it is a AK-47 because it has a four lands and grooves and right hand pistol. So on the basis of this rattling characteristics, we can identify, a ballistic expert can identify it is a AK-47, 303, SLR, revolver, pistol, because each gun having their own lands and groove mark, turning, twisting direction of the tree, and there is a width of the tree, width of the lands and groove, and depth of the lands and groove. So all these things, information, ballistic expert can give his opinion whether it is a type, it is belong to a plant. Another alternative here, there is a different caliber system. On the fired bullet, you see, rifles, lands and groove, make the when it's the one bullet passing through the barrel of the gun, make the rifles land, make the groove on the bullet while it was passed by the particular bullet. It's a reverse phenomenon. So generally, if we get the fire bullet from the synapse prime, generally deform, some bullets are hitting on the solid targets and they deform the whole portion. And it is very difficult to identify or compare the ballistic expert whether on the basis of this deformed bullet and whether it is a fired from a particular. Sometimes it takes time, but it depends upon the experts also. And he tries to identify this small patches of the striation mark on the fired bullet and and it compare with a third bullet in the laboratory, and then compare under the comparison microscope. But fragmented bullet or deformed bullet is very difficult to compare the bullet. So this is the generally the striation marks on the bullet. This is the variety of the bullet, various types of the types of the bullet. I told you this is the comparison microscope, nothing but it's a compound microscope. Here the two things can be compared simultaneously. The spiro microscope we can't compare, and there is a there is a demarcation line or there is a hair line in the both within. One side we can keep the evidence bullet or cartridge case, and another side we can keep the test cartridge case or test record bullet. So and we see under this fashion mark under the comparison microscope. And then only we can use the fashion marks or the firing pin or bridge face mark are matching with the evidence bullet. Then and then we can say that the particular bullet or cartridge case has been fired from a particular gun or not. So on the this is the comparison microscope is a very very essential instrument in the forensic ballistic division. So this is the heart of the forensic ballistic, we can say. And this comparison microscope ballistic division is not there. So this is the heart of the forensic ballistic, where we used to compare the fired bullet with the test bullet, with the test cartridge. So this is the comparison microscope. See, bullet is removed from the body of the victim, and this is the test bullet. This fraction mark is between the bullet and the victim. Suppose there is a classical characteristic of matching with the evidence bullet and test cartridge. We are not giving opinion on that also. Just suppose somebody says the four lands and grooves also getting record from the body of the victim, four lands and grooves in test bullet, and by the naked eye, can you say this bullet is fired from particular gun? No. On the basis of individual striation mark of the bullet, of the test bullet and the evidence bullet, and they under the comparison microscope, then and then only we can say that the particular bullet is fired from particular gun. That means this bullet's striation mark is very very individual striation mark is very very important. So this is how this comparison microscope will actually the small batch of the bullet or the deformed bullet or fragmented bullet. So on fired bullet, there is a this gives the length and groove when it passes through the barrel of the gun. So how the bullet is fired, and what is the firing process took place? Suppose somebody is having the gun and ammunition. When loaded the gun, what will happen? He cocks the gun, then ready to fire. And then if you press the trigger from the gun, what will happen after pressing the trigger? The firing pin will strike to the percussion cap of the cartridge. And what will happen then? Percussion cap will ignite a hot piercing flame, and this hot piercing flame will ignite the propellant within the cartridge, and then one huge amount of temperature and pressure create inside the gun, and with the help of this force of gases, projectile will come out from the barrel of the gun. So this is the firing mechanism. The bullets will come out from the barrel of the gun. So this is the how the phenomena took place. There is a primer or primer is there for a primer cap, percussion cap. The firing will hit. And this is how the burning, blackening phenomena is coming here. There is some special gas. There is a gas is coming. Bullet is also coming. The rattling of the barrel is impressed while the passing of the bullet on it. So this is how the rattling comes on the bullet. Number of bullets and 12 bore cartridge, there is a wear charging below powder wear, above the shot wear. So there is an impression of the shot because the lead is there. The lead makes impression on the shot. So suppose a scene of crime, it didn't get anything shot or anything. But these gas are not fired far away. So this if we get the over the pellet wears on the scene of crime, and we see that their impression is also there. So this particular impression is a particular number of cartridge cases. Sometimes with the help of this of this bags, over the pellet bags, you can know the type of, what type of the number of cartridges, 12 more cartridges have been in the particular bag. So this is the different types of the ammunition. So this is the, how the gunshot residue, I'm coming to the gunshot residue. When the gun is fired, so huge amount of assortment of the gases are coming from the muzzle of the gun and other opening of the gun. That means, you see, this gunshot residue is a unique in character. This is a characteristic. It's a unique particle when it's fired, this phenomenon took place. So this, you see, at the rate of 3500 degree temperature, this lead antimony barium melt in within the gun at the high temperature, and they suddenly could after come out from the barrel. So these are the gunshot residue particles. This smoke, these gases are not a simple gas, because it contains the lead antimony barium majorly, and the lead antimony barium consists main particle is a gunshot residue particle. Now there is a the science advancement is also there is a nano gunshot residue particle is also there. Now the, still the science is not much ahead make the progress on this, but people are doing the research on the nano particle of the GSR, nano GSR particle. So now it's the time for the scientists or the forensic experts to identify the nano particle of the gunshot residue. So yeah, how we are the another with the help of, suppose somebody use the rusted firearm, just like I told you, the ultimate pistol or improvised pistol. And these ultimate pistols have to be kept inside the earth, in the water. After some time, it gets rusty. And if the person used this rusted gun, then with the help of this some spray kit, some zero spray kit, we can identify whether the particular person has handled the gun or not. So yet we can identify. So this is the gunshot residue particle generally available on shooters web area as well as on the palm area. You see, this is the web area, and this is the palm area and web area where the most gunshot residue particles are present. And this we can identify how the distance determination, we forensic expert, some technique is found on the cloth or some hole caused by the bullet on the cloth are there. There is a gunshot hole maybe there. So with the help of this distance, how the expert can identify the whether the particular bullet particular hole is caused by the bullet or not, or particular hole is caused by the gunshot residue or not. So there is a there is a particular phenomena is there. You see, when somebody has fired the gun, I told you, press the trigger, take the hot casing gas will ignite the propellant, temperature pressure will create, and there is a with the help of the force of gases, projectile will come out from the barrel of the gun. So during this process, suppose there is some amount of energy, suppose 100% energy utilized to propel the projectile, but 90% energy utilized to propel the projectile, 10% energy requires back also. During this 10% required back, this gaseous also comes onto that side, that is deposited on the shooter side. So now there is a, you see, if somebody has fired the gun in the night and there is some flame also coming from the barrel of the gun or opening part of the gun. So flame also travels up to a certain distance. It depends upon the type of the ammunition. Handgun, it will have a different distance, and rifle, it will have a different distance. In the shotgun, it will have a different distance. So the if the target is within the this flame range, then somebody is fired within this target is within the flame range, that is called the burning. So burning is caused due to the hot flame. And then another is about the distance is increased. Then so you see, after fire the gun, there is some bullets come out from the barrel. Behind the barrel, there is some gas also traveling behind the bullet. And if the target is within that range, if the gas range, and they are deposited around the Ganga Sangam. That is called the blackening of the tar. So blackening is formed due to the hot gases. So if the target is within the hot gas range and they are deposited around the Ganga Sangam. So this is the form, is the form of the blackening. And if the target is again increased to some distance, few feet, then there is a some unburned propellant particle, partially burned propellant particle also traveling behind the bullet. And if the target is within that range, on the unburned propellant range, then they are deposited around the gunshot wound, and that is for the tattooing. That is for the tattooing. Tattooing is formed due to the unburned particle or partially burned propellant particle. So this partially burned propellant particle means it's a tattooing phenomena. And if the beyond the that range, suppose there is a few feet, there is we will not get the any distance determination or estimation phenomena. And in but in case of the 12 volt gun, there is a rat holes we will get it. Suppose when the 12 volt gun fired from the gun or shotgun, the pellets, a bunch of the pellets travel through distance. But after some distance, it starts to disperse, it starts to spread. So if the target is that range, then spreading range, and the most of the bunch comes, make the big hole, and there is a small pellet hole surrounding it. That is called the rat hole. So that done by the 12 volt gun. So in this way, we can identify with the help of the burning, blackening, tattooing, we can identify it's a fire from a particular gun. You know that the burning, blackening, tattooing is found by the vary from the weapon to weapon. In gun pistol, it will be vary. In rifle, it will be vary. And in shotgun, it will be vary from the weapon to weapon. So this is the different distance determination. So this is the burning, blackening, scorching. Scorching means what? There is a one ballistic phenomenon. Scorching is also there. Scorching means when the bullets come out from the barrel of the gun and it scorch the skin of the person. Due to the high spinning of the bullet, the skin come out from the bullet. So high spin of the bullet, some skin portions are come out. So that is the scorching. And singeing means due to the hot spinning of the bullet, this burns the hair of the person. That is called the singeing. That is the difference between scorching and the singeing. I already told you, burning is formed due to the hot flame. Blackening is formed due to the hot gases. Blackening is formed due to the partially burned unburned propellant particles. So this is the in this way we can estimate the range of firing. Beyond that range, we cannot estimate the range of firing. But we can under suppose 1 kilometer bullet goes and hits to the target, and that is on the basis of the instrumental technique analysis. By the scanning electron microscope, by atomic absorption spectrophotometry, or there are different instruments, we can say that particular hole is caused by the bullet or not. On the basis of lead, antimony, barium, copper, nickel, and zinc. And if we get synapse current from that one, we can say that this bullet is caused by the bullet. We are not giving the firearm discharge residue if the target is long range. So this is the difference. So this is the I have given you the flame, smoke, and unburned propellant particle. So this is the different distance is there. You see, this the revolver will be the different distance, and rifle will be the various distance, and this is the shotgun will be the various distance. I'm not repeating on this one because I already explained you. So this is the blackening. Blackening is rifle will be different, pistol will be different, and 12 volt will be different. It vary from weapon to weapon. And then there is a contact shot, hard contact shot, intermediate hard contact shot. There is a different variety of the bullet into the target. And this is the blackening. You see, different. And it's very easy. But the distance is fired, you see, there is a easy. Somebody, this gas is traveling behind the bullet, target is gaseous range, suppose, and it's very promising. There is a density of the gunshot residue particle at 3. Means very small, 3, very less distance, you will get the density of the particle. and if the distance is increasing, density of the bulk propellant particle or the gun shot residue particle, they are distributed. You see here, and 3 inch, 9 inch, and 15 inch. Here is it. 15 inch. There is it. Propellant particle also distributed widely, but there is a density very close distance. Then increase start to decrease. So that means density as well as the spreading of the unbound propellant particles also vary from distance to distance. So this is the when on photographic glossy paper the distance determination has been done on the cloth target, cloth gunshot wound. So this is the propellant gunshot residue particle, unbound propellant particle, or partially bound propellant particle. And if we can estimate the range from the bulk particle at the lower portion to the upper level. So there is a right hand thumb rule is there. So 1 inch is equal to the 1 yard. Suppose there is a 10 inch is there. That means it could be fired from a 10 yard. So this is not scientifically, but approximately we can estimate the range of firing with the help of the spreading of the scattering particle, or the we can say pellet particle. Also. This is the mainly pellet particle. Also. So this is the firearm expert should not be confused with the propellant particle and the gunshot residue particle. So there is a pellet. Creates also like a partially burned and unburned propellant particle surrounding the wound. So this is the major different aspect of the holes on the cloth target. And I think I have already told you this this one. And there is on the basis of the tactics cases, we can identify whether particular tactics case is fired from a particular cell. So we know that during the firing mechanism, what will happen? Having its own shape and size. When it's burned within this target, what will happen? Newton's third law of motion. Some amount of energy, third law of motion, we can say. Action and reaction are equal and opposite. Within the gun, during firing mechanism, what will happen there? Some brief space, this empty cartridge case also hit to the back portion of the gun of the brief case. So that whatever the irregular characteristics of the briefcase, they are deposited on the empty cartridge case. Sometimes after the firing, what will happen? Extractor of the gun will extract the empty cartridge cases, and ejector will eject from the, because extractor having their own shape and size, ejector is also having their own shape and size, and firing pin is also having own and shape size. And during the 3500 degree temperature, there is this metal is expanded. So whatever the irregular characteristics of the barrel, they are also deposited on the this empty cartridge cases during the firing process. So what cartridge case gives the vital information, whether on the basis of this vital information like a firing pin mark, breech face mark, chamber extractor, and extractor mark. So on that basis, we can say that particular cartridge case is fired from particular cell. Because for the purpose of the examination of the forensic expert or ballistic expert, this extractor, ejector, firing pin, breech face, and chamber mark are very important. Important for comparison that the particular bullet is fired from a particular gun. So this examination of the empty cartridge cases are very very important to prove or to fix whether the particular gun is fired from a particular gun. This gun or not on the basis of the fired empty cartridge cases. So this is the third 3D of the empty cartridge cases, firing pin shape, integrated ballistic identification. Now generally we generally use the optical microscope in the form of the comparison microscope. There is a up to 1x to the 40x we can get the magnification. But in this cases, with the automation also come with the help of this integrated ballistic identification system, we can identify 3D also. If we see under the comparison microscope, generally we are seeing generally 2D dimensional photograph, 2D dimensional photograph you can see. But our eyes see the 3D. or so on this basis we can identify. This is the technique. This is the this photograph I'm showing you. This is the ejector ejector mark. See under the EBIS system, and this is I have taken my during my this one. This is the firing pin mark. You see, I'm just showing you. Mr. Ranjit, my time is over or some time is left?
You have crossed your time. Double the time. You have taken it double the time.
No, I'm just giving one or two. Lastly, I will tell the what is the difference between the homicide and suicide. Then I will finish my
lecture. I think you have taken the double of the time.
Sorry. You could have told me because now you see I have a lot of slides there, but you see, a person doesn't know, and you see how the naked eye we can see, but it is a comparison micro photograph, the firing pin mark, switch mark. It's a very good to see how this type of the marks are getting on the fire cartridge. So this I want to show the our viewer. So this is the on this basis we give the opinion whether a particular bullet or firing mark has been a bullet has been fired from a particular gun. So I'm not getting your most of the time. I'm just giving you the last this one. How we identify the various whether it is a homicidal or suicidal cases in case of firearm incident. You see, generally suicidal cases, you see what will happen. Suicidal will be taken by easily accessible part of the body. Suicide who make the suicide with the help of the gun or the pistol or the handgun, he make the suicidal easily part of the body, like this one only. He will never the from the backside. Suicide will never the from the backside. But homicidal cases, there may be any part of the body portion. Okay, the suicidal will take before suicide person can hesitation shot in the room. Before suicidal person, whether he check it whether the particular gun is fired in working condition or not. So in that case, he will fire the hesitation shot in the room. But in homicidal cases, there will be no such things will happen. In generally, in suicidal cases, you see there is a gunshot residue particle on shooter's rear portion. You will get. But in homicidal cases, there may be the gunshot residue particle partially maybe get on the palm portion. There may be some gunshot residue particle on shooter's hand. Most part of the gunshot residue, the firearm identification or firearm, you see, who is going to suicide after the suicide, gunshot suicide, he is the cadaver's phasm phenomenon will be there. After the suicide, his gripping of the gun will be very tightly, but in homicidal cases, such gripping will not be there. So there may be some pretend that he makes the suicide. But cadaver's phasm phenomena is done only in case of the suicidal phenomena. In suicidal phenomena, there will be in suicidal cases, there will only one injury, gunshot injury you will get. But in homicidal cases, more than one gunshot injury. But one case also here, one option is there. So one gun can support somebody running. So one bullet can make the multiple injury also. While running, his one right hand and then left hand goes also. So one bullet can make the multiple injury also. And another case is suicidal cases, gunshot residue, we will get it on it. But homicidal cases, it may be washed out or he may be cleaned the hand. Another cases in homicidal cases, suicidal cases, he will get the investigating officer to check his marital status, check his social status, check his economical status. And on this basis, we can identify. But in accidental cases, there may be the different parameters may be there. There may be some, he's running on the loaded ammunition, on the, he's climbing on the truck, on the moving vehicles, or on the tree and other. There may be the most of the accidental situations. And mostly accidental firing took place in a cold revolver, where the most of the revolvers are right-handed cylindrical revolving cylinder. But in cold pistol only, it is a left-handed revolving cylinder. In most of the cases, the suicidal or the accidental firing took place. Thank you. Over to Mr. N. Tumarzan. And I'm very thankful to Mr. Ranjit Singh, Dr. Ranjit Singh. He has given me the opportunity to present my small work in front of you. I'm thankful to all of the, my viewers. They have listened to me patiently. Thank you, all of you.